استنى كده كده ولا ايه؟
We are very pleased today to have with us Father Georgios Kolta from St. John in West Covina, California. He's our guest speaker for 3 days. So he'll be with us today for the Bible study and for the servants' meeting. Tomorrow there will be a meeting for the couples, so please spread the word. And Abuna, basically because of the family ministry, we invite Abuna because of the book that he wrote and it's used in California now for preparation for marriage. So even for youth and those who are not married but thinking about, and for you as servants also, like working or involved with ministry, the information will be valuable. Tomorrow, hopefully, couples will be here, and on Friday with the Karma. Father Georgios, of course, also served for so many years in Egypt. He is my teacher for the pre-servant before he becomes a priest, so it's been a long, long time. He served closely with Abuna Mikhail Ibrahim, the one we have his picture and tonic outside, and at least we can learn and benefit a lot from his presence with us. So we thank him and we thank God for having the opportunity.
Name the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, amen. Communication is very important in our daily life. It's very important to know how to communicate with everybody. I'm going to tell you something about the problems of miscommunication, and then we are going to study some verses from the Old Testament to see the benefit of communication. I'm not going to give you just a lecture, but we want to discuss many things together. As Christians, we must know how to communicate well with everybody, not only with our spouses or parents, but we have to communicate properly and well with everybody at work, church, family relatives, and so on. That's why we have to avoid miscommunication. To avoid miscommunication, we have to know how to choose the words, how to choose the words, and any information you give it to somebody must be clear and in different words. For example, when I say, I will come late tonight. To what time? Late. To what time and why? Or I will do it later. When later? After a minute, after an hour, after 2 days. Well, I want to take you for a minute. Is it a minute only? Could we stop at this store for a minute? Don't be a minute. And that's why it causes arguments. Your conversation must be clear and in definite words. Second, the answer must be specific. You have to say specific answers. Somebody will ask you something and you say, I will try. Not specific. I will try. Or I think about it. There must be clear answer that the other one will not be confused. Who's hearing you will not be confused. Number three, try to speak with everybody with a low voice. Don't raise your voice. Don't raise your voice that the other one will hear and try to communicate well with you. When you raise your voice or scream, the other side will not continue in discussing anything. That's why you have to ask the person who is yelling or screaming, please cool down and practice control on your words. On the other side, if you keep silent when somebody asks you, it will be irritating for him. You have to speak and answer and know the feeling of the other one is speaking to you, and don't speak harshly with him or with her. Number four, try to avoid offense responses. Sometimes we do premature conclusions. Premature, wait, listen till the other side finish. Some people react with gunpowder words. If you just digest first and listen attentively to speaking to you, then you are going to gain your the man or the person who is speaking to you. Number five, try to avoid interruption. Listen to the end of the conversation, end of the words, and then start to speak. Give your partner to talk the way and the time he or she does. Number six, in order to make healthy communication, don't argue much. There are many things that let it pass. Don't build and keep things together. Small things, let it pass. Let it pass. Sometimes we enjoy arguing in order to prove ourselves if there are some inferiority complex, or through pride or selfishness, we continue arguing. Try to minimize arguing. Number seven, try to forget the other's mistake. The good Christian must bury the mistakes of others and don't remove it again. Exactly like when you bury something dead and try to remove it again, it will be smelly. The same. Mistakes, previous mistakes, don't think about it at all. And don't remind or exaggerate or generalize the problems. Number eight, don't give excuses for your mistakes. I'm sorry, that's it. Then you can communicate with the other person. I am sorry. It is practice from now for everybody who's speaking with you in any article, in an issue, say, I'm sorry. And it will pass. It will pass. Don't, you have to admit your faults and not repeat the same mistakes. If you blame yourself for your mistakes, you will take advantage from the other people and they will love you. Number nine, try to show interest in conversation. When somebody is speaking to you, look to his face. Don't read a book or watch the TV. Yes, go, yes, yes, yes. No. Try to concentrate. Look to his face. Try to know, and the good person must be a good listener. Good listener. It is a gift from God to be a good listener. The other people will love you and love to speak with you. Number 10, make your discussions with other person alone. Don't let people interfere in the problem. Try to this alone. As written in the Bible, if something happened wrong between you and one, try to contact him alone. Because if you let somebody listen to the discussion, he will interfere and he may cause problems. That's why one-on-one only, and not share others in the discussion, and this will destroy the relations between you and other people. Now we are going to study from the Bible. We have Bible study now, and we are going to study, if you open the 1 Samuel chapter 25 and verse 2. This story is full of ideas and skills. concerning communication. It is a nice story happened in the life of King David before being a king. You know, King David escaped from Saul, King Saul, because King Saul wanted to kill him. Thus he escaped. And if you look in verse 15, and you see that the men who were taking care of Nabal's positions, sheep, reference 1 Samuel 25, 15 and 16. We can see that the people of David were caring about the positions of Nabal. They were looking, they were very good people, they were all to them day and night. They protect them from the enemies, from the beasts, and they spent with them the season where the enemies can attack Nabal's positions. And they were, the men of David were caring about them. The Bible tells us about Nabal. He was a dumb person. His name was called like this. Nabal means dumb. I don't know why they called him like this. Yani, I know how a child will be called dumb from his birth. Yani, dumb, yani, not a beautiful word name to call a child dumb. But he was called dumb. And unfortunately, his wife said that she was a good understanding and beautiful appearance. But she was unlucky to marry a dumb person. We can see here the dumbness of Nabal appeared when the people or the men of David went to ask him something from his positions. He asked them to give them something from his positions, and they asked him politely. And what King David said, he told them, say to Nabal, who was living in prosperity, you see, four verses important. Peace to you, peace to your house, and peace to all you have. Good greetings. Start by good greetings. Number two, he told Nabal, your shepherds were with us, and we did not hurt them, nor was there anything missing from them. Ask your young men, and they will tell you. David wanted to show Nabal that the men of David was caring about Nabal's shepherds all the time. Number three, we can see from 6 to 8, from 8, therefore let my young men, how he is speaking politely to Nabal, let my young men find favor in your eyes. A very polite way. Please give whatever comes to your hand to your servants and your son David. He asked Nabal that the people who were with David, he called them your servants, and he called himself son, although he was all the Israelites knew that he would be the king. They knew well that he was anointed as a king, and he was escaping from Saul's wrath. But he tried to tell him in a polite way, your son, your son David, will be a king. but he's trying to humble himself in order to make Nabal happy. Then he greeted him, and then he was caring. He told him that he was caring about his shepherd. And number three, he spoke in a good way to Nabal in order to be kind with the David's servants. Let us go to Nabal's answer. This is from verse 10 and 11. How he started. Verse 1. Who is David and who is the son of Jesse? He tried to speak impolitely. All people knew that David saved the people of Israelites in the war against the Palestinians. And they all know that he killed Goliath. But here, this man, in a wicked way, said, who is he? Who is David? Who is David? And who is the son of Jesse? That means he knew everything about David and his origin. The second verse is worse. There are many servants nowadays who break away, each one from his master. He called David that he is a servant. He's a servant. Insult. Although he knew that David escaped from Saul's wrath. He knew this, but words full of insult. Number three, we can see unfair words in this. Shall I then take my bread and my water and my meat that I have slaughtered to my shearers and give it to men when I don't know where they are from? He knew. But here, unfair words, full of greediness. He's very rich. If he got some meat or anything, because he made the banquet at that time. But we can see how Nabal, as a dumb person, he answered the David's servants impolitely and harshly. Before we go, let us think, what of communication is that? What type of communication is that? Huh? Who can tell us? When somebody, yani, we must know how evil this man, Nabal. What communication? When you find somebody distressed or maltreated, how you can answer him? If you answer him harsh like this, what's going to happen? He's going to retaliate. We make him furious and want to retaliate. And Nabal's behavior was very bad. Of course, David was agitated. And a person who is maltreated or oppressed, we must speak with him kindly. Imagine David escaped from Saul, King Saul, who wanted to kill him, and he tried several times to kill him. A oppressed person needs to speak with him gently, but not in this harsh way. Now we'll go to the other part of the story, David's retaliation. Of course, David didn't accept that Nabal would despise him, and he considered his answers disrespectful. Of course. David, when he was agitated, he burst in anger, and he took 400 young men with him in order to kill Nabal and all his household. This is verse 22. One destroy Nabal and all his house or his household. When you are agitated, you can't control yourself. When you feel you, somebody attacks you, wait a little. Think. Don't react very fast. This is what I say, gunpowder. Try to wait. Then try to speak. Because when you are angry, you are going to behave badly. You are going to attack others. And David could not control his anger, and in his weakness he was going to commit a big crime, which will make him very sorrowful and grieve to him all his life. This is the bad communication between David and David's men and this man, Nabal. Now we can see another communication, type of communication, Abigail. Abigail was a wise woman, very wise woman. And the Bible says, had good understanding. And she was beautiful. The dumbness of Nabal was about to destroy him and his family, while the wisdom of Abigail made David cool down and reject what the evil was about to do. Abigail, you know her name. What the meaning of Abigail? Abigail means the source of joy. The source of joy. He heard from one of the young men what's going to happen. And the man said the truth when he told her about everything. It's chapter 14, verse 14 to 17. He tried to tell Abigail, take care. A harm will come to your family. Take care. The most important thing that when you trust the wisdom of some people, you can give him and convey him the message. You have to trust somebody and tell him the truth. And because he trusted the wisdom of Abigail, that's why this man told her the truth. And we can see in, from afterwards that Abigail took 200 loaves of bread, 2 skins of wine, 5 dressed sheep, 5 bags of roasted grains, 100 clusters of raisin, and 200 cakes of fig, and rode them on a dink on donkeys and went to meet David. Very fast. She wanted to stop the anger of David. How she was wise. She didn't postpone for another day. Don't let sun goes down in your anger, in your wrath. Because Satan is going to take advantage. Try to reconcile as fast as early as possible. And try to communicate well with those who are going to speak to you. That's why let us see how she did to David to cool him down. Abigail saw David. She fell on her face before David and bowed to the ground. Bowed to the ground. She fell at his feet and said very wise words. She considered herself as a maidservant and put David as a lord. And that's why she said, on me, my Lord, on me, my Lord, on me let this iniquity be. And please, please let your maidservant speak in your ears and hear the words of your maidservant. Words of humbleness, nice words, words of humbleness and meekness. And we can see the other part of her speech. Please, let not my Lord regard, don't pay attention to this scoundrel Nabal, for he, as his name is, so he. And Nabal is dumb, and he is also dumb in his behavior. Nabal is his name, and fully is with him. But I, your maidservant, did not see the young men of my Lord whom you sent. I was not present at the time. I didn't hear, and didn't see your servants, when you send them, she gave excuses to the problem. Because if I saw them, I will give them. And that's why she explained to David in a polite way the reasons that made the problem. In a good way. In a good way to make David cool down. Then the other verse. Now therefore, my Lord, look how she spoke to David. Look therefore, my Lord, as the Lord, as God يعني, lives, and as your soul lives, since the Lord has held you back from coming to bloodshed and from avenging yourself with your own hands, now then let your enemies and those who seek harm for my Lord be as Nabal. She wanted to tell him in a soft answer that the Lord will protect you and will take care of your enemies. She considered that her husband was an enemy of him because he cursed him. He cursed David, and David was anointed as a king. And that's why the soft answer can make the other person who is agitated with anger to cool down. Then she offered present to David and said, please, the word please, we don't use it. Please forgive the trespass of your maidservant. She considered that the problem is her problem, not Nabal's problem. Of your servant. For the Lord will certainly make for my Lord an enduring house, because my Lord fights the battle of the Lord, and evil is not found in you throughout your days. You did not evil at all. You saved our country from the Palestinians. You killed Goliath. We remember this. We'll never forget what you did. You didn't make an evil thing at all. Encouragement. Huh? Yet this man, King Saul, has risen to pursue and ask your life, but the life of my Lord shall be bound in the bundle of the living with the Lord your God, and the lives of your enemies he shall sling out as from the pocket of a sling. You know, the sling that David used it to kill Goliath. And you can see here how she was very wise. She praised him. She tried to speak with him in a way that he was completely humbled to listen to every word for her. He gave her ear. It's very important. When you speak kindly with somebody, even if he's angry, he will cool down. And David used the sling to kill Joel. You know, Abigail acknowledged David's victory on the Lord's enemy and praised him. Now, we continue what Abigail said. And it shall come to pass when the Lord has done for my Lord, when God has done for my Lord according to all the good that he has spoken concerning you and has appointed you ruler of Israel, when you be the king of Israel, when you be king of Israel, that this will be no grief to you. Will be no grief. She tried to tell him, take care. If you are going to revenge for yourself and you did bloodshed for, you will, all your life will suffer for what you have done. That this will be no grief to you, nor offense of heart to my Lord, either that you have shed blood without cause, or that my Lord has avenged himself. But when the Lord has dealt well with my Lord, then remember your maidservant. Abigail, very wise woman. She knew how to communicate with somebody who is angry. He's going to kill. Imagine, he took his sword, 400 people took their swords, and he's going to kill. How you can communicate with such a person? In wisdom, in a good way. And that's why the communication It's very important with somebody like this to do it in a good way, not a harsh way. And that's why she stopped bloodshed and there was peace. I want you to take benefit of this story, how you can communicate well with everybody. The second one, the second story we are going to study now, King David and his wife Michal. This is 2 Samuel 6, 2 Samuel 6, 12 to 23. 2 Samuel 6, 12 to 23. This communication between a king and his wife. We can see what's going to happen. King David brought the Ark of the Lord to his city. Look, the Ark of the Lord is more important than anybody. When His Holiness Pope Shenouda came here, how we have him here in joy, happiness, and we all were happy, right? And this is not a man. This is the Ark of God. And that's why he was very happy when he brings the Ark to his city. He offered many sacrifices and he was dancing before the Lord with all his might and singing with trumpet. His wife Michal looked from a window and saw her husband leaping and whirling before the Lord, and she despised him in her heart. Despised him in her heart. King David offered burning offerings before the Lord. When he had finished, he blessed the people and gave them gifts. Then he went to bless his household. Look, when I make the people happy as a king, I went to bless my family. When I serve the people outside, I'm going to bless my family. When I pray to the people outside, I want to pray for my family. That means he wanted to make everyone happy. What happened? What Michal said? She said very bad words to King David. And she said these bad words in front of his household, in front of the servants. Yani, if she said this to King David in her bedroom, will be less effective. But to put him down in front of servants, very bad. Sometimes we do this to our spouse. We speak violently to our spouse in front of our children or foreigners. We enlarge the problem. We don't soften it. This is what happened. Michal said, in a way, mocking way, how glorious was the king of Israel today. He was glorious? No. Uncovering himself in the eyes of the maids of his servants as one of the base fellow. The base shamelessly uncovers himself. In Arabic, it is sufaha. Safih, yani. Huh? Very bad word. To call your spouse this word. Even he did mistakes. She didn't know how to communicate. The problem that she was pride. She is the daughter of a king. Daughter of a king. But you are the wife of a king. You must respect him. And you must communicate well with him. You must be humble. Even he did mistakes, although he did it. Try to speak with him politely. This is the way of bad communication, miscommunication. Look, words of insult in front of the king's household. So David, what did David said to Michal? It was before the Lord who chose me instead of your father. She attacked him, he is going to answer his attack by another attack. We do this always. When you get furious and angry, you are going to attack. The other person, you must wait and think, he's going to attack you again. And this is what happened. King David attacked her the same. Instead of your father and all your house and all his house, to appoint me ruler or king Yani over the people of the Lord, over Israel. Therefore, I play music before the Lord, and I will be even more undignified, more undignified than this, and will be humble in my own sight. But as for the maidservants of whom you have spoken, by them I will be held in honor. I will be held in honor. Here, he tried to teach her that the Lord is more important than everything. I humble myself in front of the Lord. I try to show people that the ark must be honored. This is the ark of God. The Lord dwells in this ark. Dwells in this ark. Then I have to tell her this teaching. But at the same time, he attacked her. Of course, the Bible didn't tell us what happened later on. Of course, they start to tell her more than this. Remember, you know me? I did good things to your father. When the distressing spirit came from God in him, I was playing that the bad spirit disappears. يعني أنا كنت بطلع عفريت من أبوك. Imagine how start confrontation, because I couldn't control myself in communication. When you start discommunicating with somebody, usually we retaliate. We are not, sometimes we can't control ourselves. And when I found somebody attacks me, I tried to defend myself. But here King David not only defended himself, but he attacked her father. Your father, he committed suicide, as you know. And now I'm the king of Israel. And remember what I did to your father when he was troubled with this spirit from God. And I just played the harp to refresh him. And the King David, the result of miscommunication, King David stopped the relation with her. Another way, he just separated from her. He was separated from her. The end. You attack me in front of the servants and you put me down. Now go alone. And he broke up the relation with her. And there was written in the Bible that Michal didn't have children till she died. The bad communication, the miscommunication can destroy everything in your life. That's why we must communicate well with everybody. Think before you speak. Try to choose the words. Try to think how the words will affect the other person. Try to know that we are children of God and we are Christians, and the name of Christ must be glorified in our speech with others. Very important when we read these two stories to take benefit from it in our lifestyle. Communicate well with everybody, either your spouse or your children or your parents, all your relatives or everyone. When you serve, try to communicate with the people, good people, that you can convince them and give them the right answer, that you will not be troubled or get angry. May the Lord be glorified in our life now and forever. Amen. If you have any question,
course, it's a huge blessing for us to have Abuna Gwargyos. He's here from Covina. I'm not sure if they announced that before, but Abuna is here from Southern California. He's my father of confession, and he's the father of confession of like half the LA diocese. So he's full of wisdom. We're so happy to have him. Why don't you stand and pray? Abuna is also going to give the servants' meeting following.
In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, amen. We thank our Lord for every word that you give us in the Bible. We ask, Lord, to get benefit of everything and to learn and to fetch that we can change our style of life and know how to communicate with everybody, that they will see our good deeds and glorify you in heaven. Bless everyone standing in front of you. Bless this church and all the activities. Let us know your will in our life. We ask, Lord, to guide us in this world that will not be lost for any temptation from outside. In the name of Jesus Christ, by intercession of the Mary and all the saints, accept our prayers and say together, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth. Give us day our daily bread. Forgive our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us into temptation. But driven in Christ Jesus our Lord, thy kingdom, the power and the glory, now and forever. Amen.